What's going on, family? It's Kahim back with another video with my guy Josh. Today we're talking about Avatar, The Way of the Water, Glass Onion, and Ant-Man and the Wasp Quantumania trailer. I'm excited about this video. It's gonna be dope. Josh, how did you feel about Avatar, The Way of the Water?
That was good. I was a big fan of the first movie, and I believe I purchased that one myself back when people bought DVDs. The visuals were just, I mean, I don't think you can beat James Cameron in the visual department.
Visuals, that's, man.
Yeah. Talking about building a world, he knows what he's doing.
Exactly.
I wish he hadn't taken so long to do it, but he knows what he's doing.
Yeah, man. So let's just kind of break down what the movie was about and go from there.
Okay. Well, we'll start with a brief synopsis. Now, Avatar The Way of Water set more than a decade after the events of the first film. It began to tell the story of the Sully family, Jake, Neytiri, and they have kids now. Uh-huh. So they have built a family. The trouble that follows them, the lengths they go to keep each other safe, and the battles they fight to stay alive, and the tragedies they endure. That's a general synopsis of the movie. This has, we're bringing back all the main characters, Sam Worthington, Zoe Saldana, Sigourney Weaver, and Stephen Lang. Right. And you know Stephen Lang was the villain.
Was the villain. Back. Okay, so when the movie first starts, it's a lot of exposition. Like, they're going, trying to fill everybody in about, you know, what's been happening since, like, where they are now from when it ended.
Yeah, it feels like a lifetime has passed, right?
Right. When was the first movie? 2009.
Really? 2009. Okay. 13 years.
Wow. Time flies, man. It was good film. I felt like a lot of the exposition could have been cut out. You know what I'm saying? Just get right into the movie. Like, the people who watched Avatar, they already know what's going on. I mean, you could have had some exposition. That movie was like 3 hours, right?
Three plus. It was 3 hours, 42 minutes, I think, or James 24 Cameron, minutes.
It didn't need to be that long, brother. I just don't. I know what he was trying to do. He's trying to involve people in the world. You know, he got kids now. It's a lot going on. You got this whole other story going. Like, I don't feel like we needed to catch up like that. Like, you had the kids, you and Neytiri are, you know, living. You're the king now. Tarok, what's his name? I just felt
it's
like
it's hard to pronounce.
Yeah,
Tarok Makto. Yeah. Tarok Makto or something like that.
Yeah, and I just feel like it was a lot of exposition, man. You trying to fill
Can
in the
I
gap?
Say this?
Go ahead.
I think that was because there's been so much time.
Yeah.
So they're trying, it's like they're trying to, the movie had to go out of his way. Well, at least James Cameron probably felt this way. Uh-huh. He felt like, I need to go out of my way to catch people up who didn't see the first one or who weren't alive when the first one came out.
Right.
Because it's been so long.
Yeah, so let's do some spoilers, right? So you said the Colonel, he died in the first movie, right? So they uploaded all of his memories into this avatar, and he's charged with going to find Jake Sully and basically killing him, right? Bringing him back to the people for his crimes against humanity, right? It's basically like a revenge story. The pacing was great. Like, it was a lot of information in a short amount of time. And once, like, the war started or picked up, Jake realized that the Colonel was back and all of this stuff. Okay, we got to get out of here and go try to find a world or a place where I could protect my family. Because that was his whole thing for the film. Like, he's the father. He's the leader. He want to protect his family. I think James Cameron did a great job of framing that and setting up his motive. As a viewer, I'm just like, okay, let's get to it. And maybe because I saw the first one and I remember it so well, I'm like, bro, I could do without this. You know what I'm saying? But I hear what you're saying. I hear what you're saying. I think James Cameron, he does a great job, like you said, bringing you into the world. And you just forget that it's a computer-generated film. You know, it's like, man, I'm watching this thing. It's like, it's epic. It's beautiful. Well done. And most of it is digital. And the way they put that film together, man, like, I think the visual aspect was stronger than the story for me.
No, I can agree with that. I would most definitely say that the visual aspect was stronger than the story. The story is very similar to the first movie.
Right.
They're coming there to get resources. They put a little bit of a twist on it. Uh-huh. And maybe this is because I didn't do that, maybe I should have done. I didn't go back and watch the first movie. And I typically do that if it's been a long time.
Right, right.
Before a sequel, I go back and watch the first one. Now, the twist that they put on it, I remember one of the characters saying that Earth was dying.
Uh-huh.
So essentially, they're making it so that we understand as the audience that they're not going to give up because of this friction that they're encountering. They are coming here. They are bringing, you know, Earth civilization to this planet.
Yeah.
And essentially, you know, they're committed to it. And I think that's going to pay dividends for the other movies that are coming.
Right.
Because that lets us know.
Three or four.
Exactly. That lets us know, you know, regardless of how many times they take L's, they're going to keep coming.
Right.
And that's the twist, because like in the first movie, you know, they sent them packing. Mm-hmm. And it was like they just came here to get resources. Now they're literally trying to rebuild human civilization on Pandora. There's something else you said a second ago I wanted to hit on that didn't register until you said this. Okay, so they were avatars. Mm-hmm. When they first put on the blue bodies to be able to communicate with the people of Pandora. But then they actually became avatars for real after those soldiers that had died were then put into blue bodies. It did not connect until you just said that.
Yeah. That
they are avatars within them. It's like an avatar in an avatar.
In the avatar. Yeah. Because you saw the colonel talking to, basically talking to himself. He's, you know, filling in the gaps for this avatar. And it really wasn't him. It was just all of his memories, all of the soldiers' memories that died in the first one. And they all came back as avatars. Their bodies wasn't there, you know, because their bodies was out in the field. So when they came back to the site where the colonel died, he was just looking at his body, grabbed his skull and crushed it. You know what I'm saying? Like, he wasn't there anymore. It was just all his memory. It was a cool little twist, and I would much rather them get to that part of the movie and just shot off with that, and it would have been just as great for me. But like you said,
it would have made the movie 20 minutes shorter.
Right. Yeah. So it was a good film, man. The two brothers dynamic was cool. I was just upset, because we're talking about spoilers, we're spoiling this movie, that the good one died and the one that messed up, like, he didn't mess up, but he caused all the trouble. He lived, mm-hmm. You know, and I just like, oh, man, bro. And you got to have that heart pull, you know, that heart tug, and they have to have that motivation as, you know, the main characters to fight, you know. But he already had that. Jake already had that motivation, because the colonel was looking for him and he was trying to kill him, you know. So you didn't need his son to die, you know.
True. I agree. The issue with the sons, I don't know. That part, I'm a little, I didn't see the other son as a bad son. I felt like he got into trouble and he was pushing boundaries, but I didn't see him as a bad son. He was just the one that got into some trouble sometimes.
Yeah, he got into trouble. He was a troublemaker. He was the adventurer. He was the explorer. You know, not bad son. That was a bad choice of word. But yeah, I just felt like they could have survived, and it just been, you know, but you gotta have that heart pull, you know, things like that.
Let's talk about this spider character.
Okay, spider. Yeah.
Now, maybe I have to go back and do some research because I don't remember when he had a child.
Right, the colonel. The colonel had a son.
Yes.
And they like threw him in there too. You know what I'm saying? It's like just so, because the colonel had to find Jake Sully. So how can we make it so that it's believable and we don't have to spend this whole bunch of time trying to find Jake Sully? Okay, we just add the colonel had a son and he's been adopted, you know, by Jake and his family. He knows all the ins and outs of how they work. And you know, they life, AWA, all of that stuff. Basically, he turned his back on Jake, right? And then, you know, Jake ends up bringing him back in at the movie. At the end of the movie, he's like, okay, you know, it's like that didn't make sense to me because Jake is protecting his family. And here you have Spider basically betraying his family and he accepts him to come. It's just weird for me.
I was a little thrown with his origin, but I accepted it because, you know, part of movie watching is suspending your disbelief. So I was like, okay, he got a son. Got you. The fact that Jake took in his son also was very interesting, but I feel like that, and now that we're talking about this, kind of coming back to me, because I'm now remembering that the only reason that Jake was in the program was because of his brother. So there's like a brother's theme coming in, like, because Jake got in because his brother died and they were twins. Okay, that was in the first movie. Then you have Spider being born and he comes in as an adopted son. And then you have his own other two sons as well. So it's this kind of this, you know, the movie is essentially about family because what they did use Spider to do was they took that family, you know, although he is really trying his hardest to be, you know, one of the people of Pandora, he is still a human, right? So his whole life, he's trying to emulate and be them. And then all of a sudden, his dad is there.
Right.
And he really manipulates him because he says, okay, I'm not going to come at you the way they're coming at you. I'm going to come at you a different way. And then you can see them kind of bonding.
Yeah.
And that now, they didn't even have time to deal with that when Spider got back. So the movie actually did not address that. Now, it let us see it. So we're all over here feeling some kind of way about Spider. Because he, like you said, he essentially gave them everything. He taught them how to go get an Ekranny. I mean, he taught them how to blend in to deceive and be able to, you know, attack the people. So they didn't talk about that at all. I assume the next movie is about that because what he did at the end of the movie goes back to the fact that he made a connection with his father in the Avatar. So his character, you know, is complicated. But I can see that connection with family, brothers, betrayal. So I see that's going to be a big part of the next movie. I believe that.
Yeah, and you kind of feel for Spider because, like you said, he's been with the people. And he kind of feels like an outcast. So here his father comes and makes that connection. He's like, oh, I got somebody that understands. Even though he's an Avatar, you know, he understands where I'm at and what I'm dealing with. But then they get to the water troughs and start going in on people, like setting stuff on fire and all of this stuff, killing the people. And it's just like, I'm not down with this. and he saves this man's life at the, like, while he's, when he's dying, he's in the water, he's about to drown, he's like, you know, and he saves him, and I'm just like, what? So it's weird. Like, it was a good film. It's just like certain parts, it's like, okay, you kind of forced, you know, we talked about that with Black Panther, Wakanda Forever, like how they force certain storylines and story plots. I feel like they did that in a way with this movie.
Because they could have done what they ended up doing without him. Yeah. Going clan to clan, slashing and burning until they flush him out. They could have left the Spider character out. But I feel like they want us to be conflicted about this character.
Yeah.
I mean, I think it's actually pretty clear. They want us to feel for him, like you said. They want us to make a connection to him because he wants to be like them, you know, so bad. And then by the same token, he ends up betraying the main characters, even at the very end. He flip-flops throughout the whole movie, actually, because he's with them. Then when the father avatar comes, he helps them. He was being naive, true.
Yeah.
You know, he let himself get finessed, essentially. And then when he sees what their real intentions are, now you know who they are, but then you still at the end go back. So I think they mean very clearly for us to be conflicted.
Yeah.
And we're going to be dealing with this spider issue. Yeah, it's not going away.
He may have some villain tendencies, man. Like, you know, like he may end up being a villain because it's the father is a law. You know, he took off.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, and, man. And if you, I mean, you know, it's funny when you start discussing, you start connecting dots that I wouldn't even think about. The way he looked at Neytiri, and I go back. When they came upon the camp, they had told them, they were talking, you know, more exposition. They were told never to go to that place, right?
Mm-hmm.
So he sees where his father was killed. Like, you're seeing it impact him.
Yeah.
And then you see him see those feathers on that arrow.
Yeah.
And then you're seeing when everything hit the fan and, you know, Jake and Neytiri were coming to save them. Uh-huh. He sees those feathers again and I think he's connecting the wildness that you see in Neytiri because she's a mama bear.
Yeah,
she trying to protect her kids. Yeah. So he's seeing that, and he absolutely, even if the Colonel character dies, I think you're right. He probably will become the main villain, and they're gonna figure out a way to put him in Avatar before this franchise is over. He's gonna have a Pandoran body.
You think so?
I do.
All right, y'all heard it. Y'all heard it. Josh already said that they're gonna turn him into a Pandora body. But yeah, man, it was a good film. I enjoyed it. Like, the pacing was great for me because even though it was so much at the beginning, I'm like, okay, come on, speed up. Like, when the movie started and finally picked up, it was just like, all right, stuff is going on, you know, and it was just beautiful to look at, man. It was just like, oh, bro, it was like,
man, what did you think about the subplot of the, I forget the term. They're essentially whales, but they're Pandoran whales.
Uh-huh.
Even though I think James Cameron came out and said they are not whales. Well okay. Yeah, they're big dolphins. I don't know. They look like whales to me.
Yeah.
But essentially, there's a subplot where they're killing the whales for this substance that's like the Fountain of Youth.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's interesting. I don't know where they're going with that.
Yeah. So I
didn't see any. Go ahead.
Oh, no, I thought it was great because it just gave them more of a motive to be there. It's like, it's not just ours. Our world is dying. It's like this place is rich in minerals and it's like their creatures are rich in minerals. Like, and we can use this to further humanity. So it's a bigger agenda that they had. And I thought it was great when they stuck that thing in his, whatever that was, his brain.
It was the roof of his mouth, wasn't it?
Yeah, yeah. They opened his mouth when his mouth stuck that thing in his mouth. It's like this glowing liquid. It's like the, like you said, the fountain of youth. And yeah, that, I'm more interested in that than kind of what's going on with Jake Sully and them. I feel like their story is kind of, it's like evening out. You know, it's like, okay, where else are they going to take them? But the creatures and the world that's going on, it's great.
When I tell you he's in his world-building bag,
mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, the idea that they, and I guess it surprised me, but shouldn't have surprised me, that they actually have an area that they have conquered and have literally started building a city there.
Yeah.
So they have a foothold already. So that's the direction to go. Then you have them doing the whale hunting, yeah, to get the whatever this fountain of youth fluid is. It's, I think that's why we have all the movies that are going into the future, because he has built a world big enough that there's other things happening that we don't know about. Like when they got, now I'm colorblind, when they got to the other people, and I'm not like, I'm like, wait a minute now, I thought all the Pandora people were blue.
Yeah.
And then they got to these people and they were, now I don't know, were they light blue?
Yeah, they were kind of aqua because, you okay, know, they was in the water. They wasn't.
Got you.
They was dealing with the sun, or their version of the sun, I guess. And they were in the water. It was like the other tribe where Jake was, they was in the trees. So it was a lot of shade. The colors were brighter because they was protected more by, okay, like the large trees and things like that. But when you move over to the water people, they out. They exposed to the elements. They in the water. So they skin will like wear, like not as vibrant, you know?
Okay. And so, that's also why they had the broader, their forearms the were broader forearms, for swimming. Yeah. And then their tails were, that was funny when right, they kept saying, look at that little tail.
That little tail, right?
That was and funny.
So, okay, one more thing about this, bro. Sigourney Weaver's character, her daughter, right?
Yeah.
How is she so adept at water? You know what I'm saying? She was just so, like, she was just a part of the tribe already. Like, she was in there just sitting and just watching everything go, and everybody else was struggling.
So, okay, the first movie, you have to go back. The first movie, Sigourney Weaver's, and I don't know her character name. Her character in real life was dying, right?
Uh-huh.
Okay. They took her to the tree where Awa was. She was essentially, they were doing the chanting and all of that, and that's how they got her connected to try to get her into an avatar, but that didn't work, and right, she ended up dying, right? Uh-huh. But what we didn't know was that her avatar was pregnant.
Okay.
And they, the movie, this movie says they don't know who the father was.
Right.
We just know that the avatar was pregnant. So I said all that to say this. She is connected to Awa in a different way.
Yeah.
Than everybody else. And the movie showed how connected she is, but I don't think we really know yet.
Right.
Like, I think she's, because this is really the story of good and evil.
Mm-hmm.
This is the story of countries stealing the resources of Africa. I mean, if right, we're really going to go there, is what the story is about.
Yeah.
And
the Native Americans, you know.
Like Native melded. Americans. It's all of that is in there. So her connection is, I think, eventually going to make her like the ultimate good empowered. You know, in a way that no one else is. Right. And then, if you know anything about science, sci-fi, if you have an ultimate good, what God, must you also have to balance it out?
The ultimate evil. Yes,
you
sir,
have to.
Yes, sir.
And I don't know that we have seen who the ultimate evil is yet. I don't know.
Spider looking like it, man.
He might just be Spider. And if they can connect him the way they connected her, he's able to call upon the powers available like she is, hey, we might see some stuff.
Okay, so what would you give this movie, Josh?
Man, well, you know what? On visuals, 10 out of 10.
What?
10 out of 10 on visuals. Scoring, I thought the music was great. When the action started, I was plugged in. Mm-hmm. There was not a lagging point at all.
Right.
Runtime, over exposition. Docs it probably, I would say, somewhere between 7 and 8.
Yeah, we're on the same, we're on the same thing, because I'll give it an 8. Because that ending, man, it's just like, bro, you cannot save this dude. He did it, man.
He's like, been naive.
Yeah. It was good, man. Visuals, of course, 10 out of 10. Story-wise, I'll give it an 8. So we're moving on to the murder mystery, Glass Onion. Now, my wife, she really likes murder mysteries, like whodunits. I'm not so much a fan of them, but this film, I watched it, it was pretty good. So you wanna break down what it's about?
Yeah, The Glass Onion, world famous detective Benoit Blanc heads to Greece to peel back the layers of a mystery surrounding a tech billionaire and his eclectic crew of friends, starring Daniel Craig, Edward Norton, and Janelle Monáe.
Janelle Monáe, man, she did an amazing job, bro.
She killed it.
I didn't know she could really act like that. But she played twins, like two different characters, which really like the same character, but it was with a twist, man. She stole that movie, man, for me.
First of all, I didn't know she was in it, and she absolutely stole the movie.
Nobody.
When she came on screen, I was like, Janelle Monáe's in this?
Right. She did a great job. Edward Norton's character, Miles, he invites his friends to this island, right? And the initial goal was for him to celebrate, I guess, his millions, and he's going to do this venture. He wanted his friends to play this murder mystery. He was going to die fictitiously, and they're going to have to figure it out. But Janelle Monáe's character ends up throwing a wrench in the situation when she asks this detective to come on and actually figure out who killed her sister. Like, we're doing spoilers, right? we're going to go ahead and go. And tell the story. But these friends got together and built this company called Alpha. And I'm not really too sure about what the company was, but Janelle Monáe's character, Andy, actually started the idea of Alpha. And I guess they started becoming successful. Miles, Edward Norton, had a big vision. You know, he wanted to do this big stuff, big things. He wanted to be named in the same breath as the Mona Lisa. So he wanted to do something big. They stole the company from Andy. She actually wrote the blueprint on a napkin from this place called the Glass Onion, which was kind of like a bar where all her friends hung out. They stole the idea. And nobody would stand up for Andy in the courtroom. I'm like, bro, y'all really traded on y'all friend? Andy brought
First
Miles
of all, she ain't have no friends.
She didn't have no friends.
Bro, them people was not her friends.
They was not her friends, man. I'm like, bro, it was crazy. Jumping ahead a little bit. David Bautista, man, he's very talented. They had a discussion about who's your favorite wrestler turned actor.
First of all, how many wrestler turned actors can you name?
That I can name off the top of my head? Not that many people. And so
it's a short list, right?
Yeah, it's a short list. And I think that was
John Cena is one.
Yeah, John Cena. I forgot about him. John Cena is okay. I don't know if John Cena has the emotional depth that Batista has. You know what I'm saying? I think he has a little bit more balance and diversity in his delivery, you know. And I think that has a lot to do with him working with Marvel, being around all of those people and like gleaming from them. Cause I think his acting is, it doesn't seem forced. It's like he takes it serious. So yeah, John Cena is cool. I watched Peacemaker and I was just like,
I haven't watched it yet.
Peacemaker is good. It was cool.
It was not an enthusiastic endorsement.
Yeah, no, it was cool. It's just like, I just feel like it was forced, you know, like he's trying to get out of wrestling, you know, so how can he do that? And I'm watching him act, it's like, okay, it's kind of John Cena, you know.
Exactly.
I see him, but mm-hmm. Dave Bautista, he kind of blends in, you know, his delivery. But back to the movie, man. That movie, it surprised me because when I saw the trailer, I thought it was going to be kind of cheesy, but it wasn't. It was that twist, you know, with Janelle Monáe and her delivery. It was like, oh, she's serious. She dope. Yeah, I was surprised.
I like the movie as well because I like to try to figure things out as I'm watching. Uh-huh. And one of my gauges as to whether a movie is good is whether I can figure out what's about to happen next. Uh-huh. The way it was written, where they did not let us in until really the movie was almost over. Uh-huh. When they finally let us in,
right,
and then went backwards.
Yeah,
like we thought we were with Andy.
Yeah,
and then when they go backwards, and I'm like, oh my God, wait a minute.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, and then it starts putting stuff together.
Yeah,
that was, for me, that was really good. Mm-hmm. I enjoyed that because I had not put it together at all. The twin sister, the none of that.
Yeah.
I was wondering why, if she was so smart, why she told that box up in the beginning of the
movie. Yeah, she was, like, but she wasn't, she didn't really know. If exactly. It was Andy, she probably could have opened it, but because it was the sister, it's like, I don't know what, but I'm going to find out what's in the box.
Exactly, exactly, exactly. What's funny is, the box was more complicated than the original murder mystery that he was putting on.
Right.
I'm like, this box is really overcomplicated.
Yeah.
So this must really, I mean, they're going to really make us think about how to figure out who killed who. And then Benoit Blanc comes in. He's like, you want to know who did it?
It was Bernie. Right at the table.
I'm that like, what? Hilarious.
And at that point, I'm trying to figure out, okay, where is this story going? Because exactly. I'm thinking the whole time it's about this murder mystery, right? But and it was about a murder mystery, but it wasn't that murder mystery. And that's exactly. When I was like, ah, okay. Gotcha.
That's a good feeling in the movie though, because
yeah,
you're like, okay, now I'm in.
I'm in.
I was in, but now yeah. I'm in.
Yeah, man.
I'm trying to figure it out.
They got 007 in there, and I was just like, okay, that was lit, bro.
This southern accent, I've been in Texas my whole life and we country, but that's a little bit more country than I know.
Yeah, that's like deep south. Oh. Mississippi.
Yeah, man.
But it was a good film. I enjoyed it, man. I watched it twice. The first time, you know, you're watching a movie, you're just watching it all the way through. And the second time, you're watching, you're picking up stuff. When Janelle Monáe got off that boat and Edward Norton saw her, and he was just like, you know, he was so surprised. But this is my thing, right? Because we're spoiling the movie, if Edward Norton killed Andy, why would he send her a box? You know what I'm saying? Like, that didn't make sense to me. Like, as a writer, You know, I'm just like watching the movie. I'm like, okay, you kill Andy. Wasp in her box.
Well, you know? Maybe. You know, I'm playing devil's advocate.
Right.
Maybe he's trying to establish that he had no reason to kill her.
Yeah.
You know, if it came down to, because essentially, you know, I just invited her to a party, so why would I kill her?
Right.
Trying to eliminate, you know, trying to lay the groundwork for making it seem like everything's okay. We normally invite her. I didn't not invite her this time. She was invited just like everybody else. So
yeah,
that points suspicion away from me because I'm not doing anything out of the ordinary. Because every year, according to the movie, everyone got invited, even after right. their whole thing. So it would have maybe have been a little suspicious if all of a sudden he doesn't invite her at the same time when yeah. she gets killed.
But now that you say that, it kind of makes sense. He was just trying to cover his bases just in case they came back to him and asking him a question.
Yeah. Well, see, the other part of that is this. He had – those people were like succubuses. They were mm-hmm. the ultimate – what do you call it? Mooches.
Yeah.
Because there's no way if this guy is their essentially their bread and butter, he's the one that is making it possible for them to do what they're doing on the level that they're doing.
Right.
There's no way that any of those people were ever gonna turn on him in his mind.
Uh-huh.
Because we knew what kind of people they were.
Right.
He knew what kind of people they were. He had gotten them to lie on his behalf against her the first time, so he probably wasn't worried about that.
Right.
But it's funny that, and I think that's pretty cool, and that's like the misdirection, because you don't know it's an important detail until it all comes out at the end.
Uh-huh.
Because they had said that in the movie, like, you remember that time you almost hit me, right?
Right, right.
And then we don't realize, yeah, that was right after I had just killed somebody.
Right.
We don't
right.
find that out until the very end of the movie.
Yeah, it was a lot of nuance. And uh-huh. when they played it back, I was just like, man, they did a great job of concealing that part of the movie, like what the real motive was, the detective, like why he was really there. I really believe that he received the box. You know, he was just there. It was just part of the game. He became part of this whole experience. But then it was like they playing it back. I'm like, oh man, I need to watch more murder mystery movies like this. Because it's like it makes you think, and it makes you like, oh man, it makes you go back and like, oh, that's dope. Did a great job with that movie.
At one point, I was trying to see, was the detective the killer?
Right.
Because, you know, he was bored, and he was like, I need a mystery to solve.
Yeah.
I'm like, well, did you create one?
Right. Yeah. Yeah, man. It's good, fell. What would you give this movie? What would you give it?
You know what? This one surprised me. The comedy was there. Wow. I think they worked the comedy in pretty well. Janelle Monáe's character, I would give a 10.
Wow.
I liked her character, like, really, I liked her character a lot. Like,
yeah.
the going from the uptight, you know, tech entrepreneur to her country bumpkin sister.
Yeah.
She did great. She carried the movie for me. So right. I would say at least an 8, and then some of the other deficiencies, you know, kind of bring that 10 down to an 8. So 8 for me.
I would say a 9, right?
Okay.
These are my two reasons. Okay. One, when Janelle, when she tore that place up and Edward Norton's reaction, and he was so upset, but it was so funny, like why he was going off on the steps, like he couldn't do nothing about it. Like that part, and just the fact, like you said, the way she played both of those characters, it was separately, but it was together. And I was just like, wow, like I didn't expect that from her. So, and Leslie Odom's, man, I like what he does.
He's like good.
Dave Bautista, he surprised me. But they had a great cast. Man, they had a great cast. So I would give it a 9. And Edward Norton is just one of my favorite actors, bro. Like Fight
Now, this
Club.
is what I will say on Dave Bautista. Okay. I think this is probably one of his better acting movies. I'll give him that.
Okay.
I didn't, the zombie movie he was in,
I didn't see
it. I didn't care for it all.
Okay.
He was squint acting.
Okay.
But,
squint acting?
But in this movie, he did a whole lot better. He was funny. He was really funny. After we got into it, just like on the previous movie, the box wasn't even necessary. I mean, if you eliminate the box and just say that they got invitations, the movie is the same movie.
It's still good.
But and I guess it's still good.
It's setting up Edward Norton's character beat to this extravagant guy. You know, he got all these paintings. He got a car that he can't drive on his island. You know, so it's like
literally a car up on a pedestal.
On a pedestal, bros, and he can't drive it. It's just like he does all this unnecessary stuff to make him feel bigger than life, larger than life. Yeah. So this box was a part of that experience, and that's kind of what I took it as. It's like it didn't need to be there, but for his character, it makes sense that it would be this extravagant box. This little invitation.
That's true. And I agree with that because the whole house was just over the top, everything.
Over the top. You got this robot walking with carrying the luggage. It's like, what? But yeah, it was cool, man.
I'm glad I watched it.
To do this.
Get to this trailer.
This trailer.
Let's get to Kang.
I'm a Marvel fan, bro. Like, and it's hard being a Marvel fan and being objective because their stuff is just so massive, bro. It's like, it's a whole experience, bro. And I'm like, we're gonna watch this trailer.
You're an interesting man, Scott Lang. You're an Avenger. You have a daughter. But you've lost a lot of time.
Jail just like her.
We can help each other with that. Who are you? I'm the man who can give you the one thing you want.
Bro.
What's that? Time.
Can rewrite existence and shatter timelines. You cannot trust him.
I don't care who this guy is. I just lost so much. He can give us a second chance.
Okay, y'all at work.
Second chance.
Make this easy for you. You will bring me what I need, or everything you call life will end.
This is all my fault.
Oh, look at that.
You may not want her to watch this.
We had a deal.
Oh, God.
You thought you could win.
I don't have to win. We both just have to lose. I'm sorry, Cassie.
Let's go. February 17th.
Man, it's gonna be good.
It's gonna be amazing. It's gonna be amazing, bro. It's Jonathan Majors season, man.
Yep.
So exactly. I'm guessing this is after Spider-Man and all of that. Is this like the new? It's like the new era in Marvel. I'm guessing, right? It's like
it has to be after Spider-Man because It has to be after Spider-Man and after Doctor Strange 2.
Right.
Because they're dealing with the ramifications of what happened in the Spider-Man movie. This is also after Loki.
Okay. Yeah.
As well. Because we know that we see Kang at the end of Loki.
Right.
So Loki is happening somewhere in there too.
Right. Man. Bro. And that's what I'm saying. Like, it's just so massive. But they still keep it in line. It's like you really under, if you watch Iron Man 1 all the way through, it's like you watching one long movie. It's like, but it's like different characters, different experiences, and now they got Kang. Bro, it's gonna be crazy. And going on this ride, man, bro,
let me tell you, when it comes to continuity,
yeah,
Marvel is the king of that. Okay. And what you just said is proof, because everything, even the solo movies, everything has a place.
Yeah.
Even some of the duds,
mm-hmm.
you know, and some of them are more encapsulated than others.
What would you consider a dud? Like a Marvel movie, what would you consider a dud?
That I have watched?
Uh-huh.
I think that third, either second or third Thor movie wasn't that great.
Yeah, the last
third Iron Man movie wasn't all that great either.
Okay.
Now wait a minute. Was the third Thor Ragnarok? Maybe it's the second.
Yes.
Thor. No,
it was the third one was Ragnarok. Because
that's the best Thor movie. Okay, the Dark World was eh.
Yeah.
Ragnarok was probably the best Thor.
Right. I would say that.
Thus far. And then that third Iron Man.
Yeah. With the Mandarin.
And him having the anxiety attacks and all of that. I couldn't get into it.
Yeah. That was kind of dead. I would say that.
Yeah, Eternals. That one. Is probably a dud for me, but they are probably at the top of the MCU dud list.
Yeah.
Because I would say that would probably be the movie with the least continuity.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're introduced to these characters that are supposedly existing the entire time with these really big powers, and you're telling me that they are just there?
Yeah.
Nobody knows that they're there.
Yeah.
And we all of a sudden find out they're there because their movie comes. I don't know, but I agree. They have so much broad source material, and they're probably going to be a little bit of victim of that success, because how do you beat Endgame?
I think they're going to do really, it, man.
It's, huh?
I feel like they're going to do it.
And I think that they can,
mm-hmm.
and it would make me an even bigger fan.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm loving this. This will be my first time really rooting for the villain, because my favorite Marvel character is not in there anymore.
Yeah. Okay. So who's that?
And that's Black Panther. T'Challa is dead. So.
Yeah. He's gone.
I'm pushing for Kang.
And the more I think about it, the more I dislike the idea of not recasting T'Challa. Like, the more I think about it, it's like, bro, like, he needs to be there. So it's like, how are they going to make that work? It's like, man.
We're going to have to trust the process, apparently.
Yeah.
We're going to have to just trust and make it work. But I'll be pushing for Kang. We'll see. I think, like you said, he's going to be giving them the business.
Oh, he's going to be giving them for probably work. About
at least three or four movies.
Yeah, man. It's exciting, man. It's exciting being a Marvel fan. Like, just, a person that didn't really get into the comics and just watching all of this stuff play out, it's like, I'm watching this stuff and I'm taking it all in for the first time, and it's just seeing how they progressed and you know, I'm wondering how Kang's, like, his power, like, I'm looking like, man, he got the phase, like, whatever that is, the laser. I'm just like, bro, what else he gonna be doing? Like, it's just like, oh, man.
He's and I think that realm. setting where they are, mm-hmm. this is just a theory of mine. I think that is the outside of the TVA. That building that you see,
yeah,
I think that's the TVA.
Okay. And Industrial Light and Magic, I think they do this, the special effects for the whole Marvel thing. Like,
okay.
The way they build out the worlds, bro, it's just like you've seen that when they stepped out and they saw all like the buildings and everything turning and like in the background, it's like, man, bro, like.
Hours and hours and hours and hours and weeks of CGI work.
Yeah, man. You did a great job.
That'll be one of the upcoming reviews, so yes, stay tuned.
Yes, definitely, sir.
We'll be reviewing that
one. Yeah, we definitely going to be doing that because anything Marvel, bro, it's on. And Jonathan Majors season, we got Creed coming up. We still haven't watched Devotion. I want to watch that one. He's very talented, man. And shout out to the brother. Killing the game.
Yes, yes, yes.
That's it, bro. Anything else you want to say, Josh?
I'm good. I enjoyed. Thanks for having me again.
Oh, man. I feel like we're going to make this permanent, bro. I feel like we're going to make it permanent.
Let's do it.
Man. But, yeah, man, let us know what you're watching. Put that in the description. We'll check it out, man. You have a light that is out of this world. Let it shine and be the richness that this world deserves. Much love, family. Be rich.